Good morning.
Good morning.
Nice to see everybody here today on this bright, sunny, no rain day. Okay, but it's only started, so we'll probably have our afternoon showers. But the beautiful thing about this weather is that everything is so green and flowers are so vibrant. You know, so we're going to benefit from this rain, even though it's a bit of an annoyance. I'd like to welcome Angela and Steve back again today, and they're going to be our worship leaders. Okay, and so they'll let us know what they're going to be doing, and they've got it under control. I wanted to remind the congregation of our meeting after the service next Sunday to kind of talk about our current situation with Brian. As you know, Brian is still back in Tennessee, and he's dealing with the aftermath of the passing of his brother, so there's a lot of work that he has to do, so he's not going to be able to be with us today. Our guest speaker today is Steve Van Ostran. He's the executive director for the region. He's an old friend of ours. He's not that old, but he's a very good friend of ours, and he's been with us many times, so he'll be delivering our message today. And I'd also like to just say Happy Father's Day to all the fathers visiting with us today. We wouldn't be here without you, so thank you very much. My opening thought today has something to do with Father's Day. I have this poem that I recently found, and it's by James Cagney. That's not the actor, but it's the poet, if you've ever heard of him. But it's called, and it's kind of long, so bear with me, but I think it's a very good poem. And it's called Open Letter to Henry. It is so strange, the photograph I was given of you, because the man in it is me and not me. It is me in costume. It is me at a distance, squinted into focus. Everything I do not know about myself has been buried with you. As I settle into a man I do not know, I become a mystery to myself. How many times have I laughed, coughed, whispered, heard your voice echoing through me? How many times have I missed you, waving back at me from behind every mirror while I shaved, washed my hands, cut my hair? How many times have you touched me with my own hand? My inheritance probably lies in habits that annoy me the most. The sound I make clearing my throat, broad toss of my chest when I walk, or the desolate silence we shared in our heads, in our empty rooms, in our isolated youth. How many times have we been so alone, we overlooked one another standing as close as any man can to his own shadow? I don't know about you, but I do think of my father when I read something like this. So, if you will stand, if you are able, for opening music.
Our opening song is I Will Bless the Lord at All Times, number page 86 in the small book that you just passed out.
Oh,
time, we will now have our prayer offering.
So there are a number of prayer concerns that we want to lift up today. We will, of course, want to remember Brian and his family as they deal with the loss of his brother Nick back in Tennessee. Also, on Monday, we heard that the former pastor at Canyon City passed away. He's been dealing with cancer. Appreciate your prayers for that. I have not made this broadly public, but I've been on the road a lot this week, which is one reason my colleague, Reverend Perry, is here with us today. Reverend Perry is the ministry and mission coach for your congregation, as well as a number of others. But my son had a motorcycle accident on Thursday, and so I had to go to Wichita. He had surgery yesterday to fuse the vertebrae, but he's doing well, and appreciate your continued prayers for him. And so I just ask that you lift up my son and for his recovery and the family as we deal with all that stuff. So let's pray together as you thank God for many gifts in even these situations. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for this congregation, for their faithfulness to you, and for the fact that you show your love to us in so, so many ways. Lord, we know there are challenges in our lives. We lose loved ones, and we deal with situations that we oftentimes create for ourselves. And yet, Lord, you walk with us, and you bless us, and you make us feel good about the life that you have given us. And so today, as we come to prepare to receive this offering, we give a gift back to you. A gift of joy, a gift of gratitude for what you have done for us. You have blessed us in so many ways. And so we ask, Lord, that you will receive the gifts that we're about to offer as a thanksgiving for your love for us and today especially as a thanksgiving to those fathers who cared for us in so many ways. We ask in my son's name and in your precious love, amen. We're going to ask our ushers to come and you give as the Lord leads this morning.
We're going to do some special music today for all the fathers. Songs called Leader of the Band by Dan Fulford. Reminds me of my father, and I'm sure as he is the leader of my family. So. Yeah.
you, Angela and Steve. What a very beautiful and fitting song for Father's Day. And I would like to once again introduce our guest speaker today, Steve Van Ostran.
Our text this morning . So we're going with the flow today, so we apologize for it being a little disconnected today. There have been, as you all know, there's been a lot of things that challenges and changes that have gone on with the past few weeks, and so invite you this morning, if you have your Bible with you, to turn to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9, and we're going to just read a few short verses this morning, beginning at verse 35. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. And when he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to the disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." I grew up in southeast Kansas and southwest Missouri, and the harvest was always kind of a special time. If you know anything about Kansas, they're famous for wheat. Better than Iowa, which is famous for corn, and Nebraska is famous for corn. Wheat, you know, is the breadbasket and all that, but it's a little different harvest idea. You know, it's actually, in my trips to Wichita and through southwest Kansas, it's almost ready to harvest right now, except for one thing: a lot of rain, and the fields are muddy, and the fields are wet. But you know, and still happens some, but it used to be that the harvest, they started down, actually they would start down a little further south, maybe in Oklahoma, and they started in Oklahoma as it matured, and they'd move up, the crews would move up north and kind of east as they went along, and they would just harvest as they, the wheat as it matured and as they went north. And so that was always a special time for us when we knew that the harvest crews were working. And it was all, I never got to work on one of those crews, but you know, you always had, it seemed like you had some friends who would work on the harvest crew for a summer. And it was a hard job, but it paid fairly well. And it was kind of a special thing for us. Now, you know, they, of course, a lot of that is done with machinery, and you don't need the big crews that they used to have and whatnot. But you still, it's still an important time for many of our churches and the church members we have who grow wheat. When harvest is around, they may not be there on Sunday morning because they're driving the grain truck in to load the grain into the silos and to make sure everything gets done in a timely manner. It's an important thing. But in this passage, there's something even more important. Jesus had seen that it was time for the harvest, and so he asked us to pray for people to come and work in the fields for the harvest. Now it's kind of an interesting Matthew. Normally we read this passage, I read it out of Luke. Luke is probably my favorite gospel, but in this passage, the Holy Spirit led the writer of Matthew to do something a little bit different in this particular passage. You see, we think, we're not sure where this took place, you know, where this took place. There is some suggestion. We were, Rodney and I were on a trip to Israel back in January, and by the way, we will be leading a trip in 2024, about this time of year, June 18th to the 28th next year. We will have more information. If you have never gotten to visit Israel and would like to visit Israel, we would love to have you join us on that trip. We'll have the details on that, sorry. I consider that a PSA we would love to have you join us on that. But we were there in January with kind of a part of our doing this trip is one of the things that we hope to provide for our pastors is two things. One, we want them, every one of our pastors, to have the opportunity to have a cross-cultural mission experience. And we've worked hard at doing that through the years, and we feel like most of our pastors have had that opportunity. We're in a time where we have a lot of churches that are looking for new pastors. And so we recognize that we're going to have to continue that process of making sure that our pastors have that experience. Because as you know, because you are a very missional church, and many of you have been to the mission field with John in various capacities over the years and whatnot, you know that you see the world differently once you have been on the mission field and you see how other people live and how the world treats them. And it just makes a difference in how we understand the world. So you know what I'm saying and how important that is, and so we continue to do that. And then the other one is, if any of our pastors want that opportunity, you see and read the Bible differently once you've been to visit Israel. It's not that you don't need to go to Israel in order to understand the Bible, but it does help you understand the Bible differently, is the way I would say it. So it's a great experience. And whomever your pastor is at this time next year, I hope that they might be able to join us in that, if it's a desire that they have. But anyway, when we were in Israel, just outside of Bethlehem, it's actually a little bit to the north and to the east of Israel, are fields of wheat. And the story goes that Jesus was sitting there and watching people come out and said, you know, just and seeing the wheat, and he said, you know, the fields are ripe for the harvest. And so pray that the Lord of the harvest would send workers out into the field. Powerful, powerful image. But in Matthew, something different happened. Now, if you go back and you read the first part of Luke 9, you're going to see some interesting things. With the week I'm coming off of, it kind of feels like my week. But Jesus begins by being asked to heal. I'm going to get the order wrong, but he heal a deaf and dumb, I believe, and then a blind man, and then he's on his way to heal the girl, to raise the girl from the dead, and then it's the woman with the issue of blood, and there's all these things that happen, and then we get to this passage where they were like sheep without a shepherd. Pray that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Pray the Lord of the harvest. So. Now, we are pretty sure that Matthew did a lot of editing. That Matthew, when you read his text, while it is somewhat chronological, while it somewhat follows the order of what Jesus did, we're pretty sure that Matthew kind of combined some things together. It's very, I mean, the Sermon on the Mount is powerful, but it's very, you know, you usually have some general theme as you're trying to put together a teaching or a sermon or whatnot, and it's not that it's disjointed, but it seems like it's several little snippets. Some of the best, it's kind of like when you watch late night TV and they take a Carol Burnett show and they show all the kind of the best pieces of Carol Burnett. Well, that's almost what the Sermon on the Mount seems to be. It's some of the best pieces of teaching that the disciples remember that are put together and compiled there. And I think that makes me think that possibly Matthew is putting together, he's trying to say that Jesus you know, he went through this period of time where he was just healing people. He was meeting their needs. He was seeing, he was in their midst. He was taking care of them. He was doing what it took for them to know that they were loved and cared for. Now, what he's doing is not wrong. He's just saying, you know, there was this time that Jesus did this, and there was this time that Jesus did this, and there was this time that Jesus did this. And then after all this happened, there came a point where he said, you know what? The harvest is plentiful. They're like sheep without a shepherd. There's all these needs. The harvest is plentiful. Pray that the Lord of the harvest would send out workers in the field. And then, if you read on, and I didn't read that part of the passage, if you read on into chapter 10, guess what? That is in Matthew where the sending out of the disciples into the villages to go to the disciples without, you know, to don't take a bag with you and teach these things and all. That's when it takes place here. You see the flow? You see the flow? You've got Matthew showing that Jesus saw all the needs of the people, all the concerns that they had, all the hurts, and he's helping them, he's blessing them, he's encouraging them, he's using them, and then he makes this statement, and then he sends the disciples out. It's kind of a nice little progression here. But what I want you to focus on are two things. Remember, it's an agrarian society. And so when they use metaphors, often the metaphors are agrarian, agricultural. The first one is one from husbandry. It's like sheep without a shepherd. They need someone to take care of them. And then it's agrarian, but it's not husbandry. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Now I want you to focus, the harvest is plentiful. What were they harvesting? They weren't gathering. He's not using imagery of a hunter and gatherer. And on my dad's farm in middle Missouri, they have a field of blackberries. They don't cultivate those blackberries. Those blackberries grow wild. But every year we would harvest blackberry. We actually didn't harvest them. We gathered blackberry. You don't harvest blackberries. That's something that just is given. It's out there naturally. What you harvest are fields that you have prepared, are fields that you have planted, are fields that you have done work in and tended to and cared for. So where is the harvest in the picture that I've just talked about? It's in the people that Jesus tended to and cared for in the previous chapter. It's in those people who are blind and need sight, those people who are deaf and need to be able to hear, those people who are lame and need to walk, those people who are hungry and need to be fed, those people. That harvest, that field that Jesus was talking about, the people that he tended to were those people that he took care of in that community, in that world. People that established religion kind of forgot. He was taking care of those people, and he said, the harvest, this is my field. This is where I need workers. These are people that I need workers. These are the people you need to take care of is plentiful. But the workers are few. And so in chapter 10 it says, he gave to his disciples power over all things, and he sent them out, and don't take a bag with you. And it's also in Luke chapter 10 is where you find the sending out story. And he basically says, go in there and meet their needs. Heal the sick. Feed the hungry. Meet the needs of the people. And proclaim the gospel. Proclaim the gospel. Proclaim. Let them know that I have come to say that you are loved. You are loved. And the way that you know that you are loved is because I have been caring for you. I've been taking care of these needs. But these are just physical needs. You are loved for all eternity because I come from the Father. And the Father sent me because the Father loves you. It's not just caring for the physical needs of the world, but it's letting them know that they are loved by the one who created this world, the one who exists beyond this world, the world beyond which we have a hope for. I don't care who you are, beyond which we have some sort of belief in, and that one who exists beyond loves us enough to send us his Son as a messenger, as a harbinger of the hope we have for eternity. And he's saying that hope for eternity comes through me, through Jesus, through relationship with me. And he commissions his disciples to go out and to take that very same message that he is communicating to the rest of the world. Today, you and I are those disciples. Now, I'm assuming most of you in this that are here today, you're here because you have experienced that same type of grace that I've experienced. We experienced this this week when my son had his motorcycle accident. It was one of those accidents, you know, he could have been dead. We know we live in a world that good, bad things happen. And he was riding his motorcycle, hit some gravel, flew off the bike, landed on his back. Fortunately, he was wearing a helmet, he was wearing a jacket. He has a concussion, he has a broken back. But that's grace. He's alive. And he can proclaim that fact that you know, yeah, I took the right precautions, but God spared me. It's grace. And we know it's grace. And because we experience grace in this world, and that's just one example. We experience grace every day. You know, for us here in the United States, just the fact that we live in this country where we have religious freedom, where we have some type, I mean, the reality is, yeah, there's some violence here, but I'm not worried about a missile being launched into the center of town because another nation wants the oil and the coal in another part of our country. I don't have to worry about that. There's some safety here. We have wealth. You know, if you go down, if you're worshiping in Nicaragua today, in the churches that we support down there, and you happen to need to go to the restroom in one of the churches, you would go to a literally, it's just a hole in the ground. That's the restroom they have. That's where the pastors, they worship in the kind of the carport of the pastor's family house, and their restroom is that old. I mean, we had that in the past, didn't we? Some of you grew up with that. Yeah, that was how we used the restroom on my grandmother's farm when I was growing up. It's not too far in the past, but most of us today have a nice restroom in it. And there's a nice restroom here in this building. And it's a comfortable building. And the light switches work. And, you know, we have experienced grace in this world. And because we have experienced that grace, we can go out and proclaim God's message of love to those who have trouble seeing that grace. We can go out and be that gift of grace in the lives of many. And I'm not just talking about people in other countries. I'm talking about people outside these doors. Because all those things that Jesus did in chapter 9, there are still people who are sick and need to be healed. There are still people who are blind and need, we may not be able to give them physical sight back, but we can be their eyes. We can be their ears. We can bless them in other ways. Sometimes in the church, we spend too much time basking in the grace that we have received and forgetting that next part of the message, that the field is ripe for the harvest. And God needs workers to go out into the field and to tend to the field. This is not about evangelism and getting more people in the pews. Ultimately, that will happen. But it's a call to be His worker, to be His hands and feet in a world that needs to know Jesus, needs to know God's love. That's the message that this passage is trying to convey to us. It's a message that each of us needs to hear in our own way. None of you here is unable to help tend the field. You may not harvest as much as Reverend Perry, but you may harvest in an area that Reverend Perry can never work in. God is calling you to be a part of the harvest, to be a part of the harvest crew, and to enjoy the fellowship, the love, the pleasure of knowing that those whom you minister to, those whom you share the gospel with, will have in knowing the same Lord that you and I serve. Let us pray. Father, we know that the harvest is plentiful, and we know that the workers are few. And while most of us here have tried to be workers in the field, sometimes we've gotten tired and we've gone back into the house. We've sat a little too long around that luncheon table. So Lord, as we hear your call, that there's still work to be done. There's still souls to be harvested, people to be served, fields to be tended. We ask that you would give us the energy, give us the desire, give us the vision and the directions to work in the field that you have called us to. We ask it in your Son's precious name.
Thank you, Steve, for the message today. Please stand if you are able for our closing music. And please remain standing afterwards for our benediction. And I want to make sure and invite everybody to stay behind after the service and join us in the fellowship area in the back to visit and enjoy some refreshments and to meet any new faces.
So our next song is also in that smaller book that was passed out to you. It's called Rejoice in the Lord Always, number 81. And we're going to sing it three times. And we're going to be happy. It's a really happy song. So we're going to go pretty fast. So here we go. It's around, actually. Rejoice, 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 rejo Page 9 teaches what yet we may be. Benediction first, do you want to do that first? Benediction, just. Okay, all right, here we go.
Dismissed.